praise in the house? How many in the house are thankful that he knows your name tonight? Amen.
He counts the stars, one and all. He knows how much sand is on the shore. Sees every sparrow that falls.
Confidence tonight.
I take every move that I
you what's in store. Don't know a lot of things. Don't have all the answers to the questions of life, but I know in who.
A word from God tonight. He knows who you are. He knows your name. When you can't see the light of day, when seemingly everything that can go wrong has gone wrong, but you know he's still there, and he still cares, and he still has you in the palm of his hand. Hallelujah. Praise the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. So good to see you in the house of God. We're glad that you're here tonight. It's just good to be here on a midweek service. Good to be in his house. Hallelujah. Praise the Lamb of God. I want to remind you of our Sunday morning services. They will begin at 10 a.m. We will not be having Sunday school, but they'll begin at 10 o'clock. Come expecting a great time in the Lord. And we want you to come a little early. We want to take your family's picture. And we'll have stations throughout the foyer, and we want to take your family's picture. And then a few days after that, when you come back to the house of God, we will have that a picture for you. You'll just have to look through them and get yours and go on. But we're going to have a picture for you. Hallelujah. Welcome to Mid-Holy Week. Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a hand. This is Holy Week. Holy Week. He's going to be crucified in a few hours, but Sunday morning's coming. Hallelujah. Praise the Lamb of God. I want to say thank you to all of our preachers and teachers that have filled in for the past few days and allowed my lady's Christmas gift to come to fruition. And I went to Barrett Jackson. Hallelujah. I got my t-shirt, got my bid number, bid on things, sat right next to a guy that paid $200,000 for Dale Earnhardt's race car. I thought he was crazy, but just a wonderful time. But I tell you, I don't say this about live stream. If you haven't experienced live stream, going down the interstate at 80 miles an hour, speaking in an unknown tongue, while your lady sat next to you hollering, "Oh Jesus, oh Jesus, oh Jesus." It is an amazing experience. But it was awesome. These preachers that God has blessed this house with did an awesome job. Hallelujah. But it's good for Pastor to be back home tonight, and good to see my family, and good to be here. We believe in God's very best for you in this season that we're presently in. It's a confusion hour for the world, but for the saint of God, it's a sure hour. I said, for the saint of God, it's a sure hour. An hour that is sure, an hour that is filled with a future and destiny, an hour that's filled with certainty. And I'm thankful to be living in this day and time. And I want to say this to you. I don't care what reports you received, whether they be good or bad. Before any of those reports could come to fruition, the trump of God could sound. Hallelujah. And the dead in Christ could rise, and we which are alive and remain, we could be snatched up off of planet Earth and go home to be with God. Hallelujah. I am filled with the excitement and expectation of that moment and of that hour. I want you to be praying for my son. He leaves on TDY. I think it's, where'd Forrest go? I think it's tomorrow, Saturday. So be praying for him, that God's hand would be upon him. Give him safe travel. Be praying for all of our people that is connected to our military forces, and pray for our military forces, that God would be with them and touch them during this very, very special time. Take your Bibles, please, and turn with me to the great book of 2 Timothy. And I know I'm going to be taking you to a very familiar passages of Scripture, but I think it's a moment in time that we need to deal with. And I was so impressed to take the home crowd there tonight. And while you're turning to 2 Timothy chapter 3, I want to remind you of our SOS meeting tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. Ladies, bring salad and come expecting to get both your physical and spiritual cup filled. I believe Sister Lisa is going to be bringing us a word tomorrow night. So ladies, come. I promise you, you'll be blessed by the teaching of the word. 2 Timothy chapter number 3. Hallelujah. I just want to say this. Our Kingdoms Kids Sunday School hour, or whatever we want to call that, couple of hours, last Sunday had 15 new kids that have never been to Milligan Assembly. And we thank God for that. 15 brand new children that had never been here. And we thank the Lord for that. 2 Timothy chapter 3, I want to begin reading at verse number 1. This is what the Apostle Paul said to a preacher boy by the name of Timothy. Most Pentecostals can just about quote this scripture by heart, but those that are looking for the coming of the Lord can not only quote it, but they can feel it in their spirit. And they can know by the times of the day and the season of the hour that we live in, surely the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. And it's here upon us. This is what Paul said. He was speaking of the wickedness of the last day as he was foretelling it. He said, this know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall become lovers of their own selves. They become covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, and unholy. And I could spend an entire service on each one of those, but I want you to look at the season of the hour in which we live. You want to know why the world's in a mess? Because Jesus is about to come. It's the last day and hour in which we presently live. He said, there'll be those that are without natural affection, truth breakers, false accusers. He said, in contempt, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away, for this sort are they which crept into the houses and led captive silly women laden with sin, led away with divers lusts, ever learning and never able to come to know the knowledge of the truth of God's word. Now I go to chapter number 4. I just want to tag it with this because it was Paul as he was expressing himself both in his spirit man and in his fleshly man. You see, Paul, he had a struggle. He had a struggle with his mind and his physical body because he said, when I got my body under subjection, then there became a war within my mind. And they can't nobody in here tell me that you've never had a war going on in your mind, even though God and you, through the power of the Spirit of God, had your fleshly man under control. Then there became a battle of the mind, battlefield of the mind. In chapter number 4 and verse number 1, he said, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word, be in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. And then he said, for the time, everybody shout time, will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and they shall be turned into fables. Paul dealt with the world, and now he's dealing with the church. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and they shall be turned into fables. But watch thou, in all things endure affliction, for the work, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. For I am now ready to be offered, and the what? Time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course, and I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them that love his appearing. I want you to go back to chapter number 3 and verse number 1. This though also, that in the last days, perilous what? Times shall come. I want to preach to you tonight just for a few moments on the subject, in times such as these. In times such as these. When I was greeted by our elder statesman, Brother Boland, I could not help but wonder, in his time of life, what his eyes have seen. I thought about our elder pastor back there. I thought about today, about what times he has saw as he has pastored and preached the gospel all the times. And I want to tell you something, and I want you to hear, Pastor, and I want you to hear me well. In all my years of ministry, in all my seasons that God has taken me through, and the times of his outpouring, and the times of trial, and the times of great victory, and the times of moments that has come upon planet Earth, and it has engulfed families, and it has come upon the church, I have never seen such times as this. I've never seen it. The hour in which we're living in today. Let's talk about some things. Heavenly Father, we love you today. We thank you for the power and the anointing of your presence and the touch of God's power that is so evident inside of this house. I thank you, Jesus, for the privilege that I have to stand in your courts and gates again, that I stand behind your sacred desk and I proclaim to those that you love more than me this gospel. I pray, God, that it touches our heart, that it lifts us up above the ordinary planes of life, And God, it breathes upon us the unadulterated breath of God. And God, I pray in that breath, Father, we'll find hope and strength for the journey. In that breath, God, that you breathe upon us, we'll find adequacy of power, that we'll be able to look at the adversary and say with a surety, greater is he that's within me. And get behind me, Satan, and walk in that might and power of the breath of God upon our life. God, let us walk in the liberating might of God, that nothing, no form, no principality above or beneath is able to come against us and contain us and restrain us in our spirit or stop us in our mind and in our fortitude for living for you in this last day, God. I ask you to take the church through every storm, take the church through every battle, every struggle, and on the other side, God, give us total victory. God, let us stand up with the redeemer of the Lord and say, I know my God is abundantly able to supply, to heal, to meet every need, to save to the uttermost, to lead us out, to meet our need in a very pressing hour. And today, God, I ask you to move upon every individual in this house, for I know it's not by might or power, but it's by thy spirit. And God, I ask you to anoint thy sanctuary with the presence of thy glory. Let us stand in it. Let us worship in it. Let us stand in awe in it at the awesomeness of your might and the awesomeness of your power. Have your way inside of this house. God, I rebuke the devourer for the sake of the hearer. I rebuke the devourer for those that comes in this house. I rebuke the devourer for their sake, God. And I ask you to allow us to stand in the might and the fulfillment of the power of your word. And God will give you the glory for it in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen and amen. Give the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords a hand clap of praise for the reading of his word. Why don't you just stretch your hand up and worship him a little bit. God, we love you tonight. We praise you and we give you glory and we give you honor. You may be seated if you can. You see, the struggle in Paul's life was really no different than the struggle in ours. It was a time in the gospel that it was fresh and it was new and it was being poured out on planet Earth. It was being poured out in a great way, but it was being mixed with the cold, lifeless death of spiritual religion. And it was being mixed with that. And Brother Johnny, that was the reason that Paul said, I don't come to you with enticing words of man's wisdom, but I come into you in demonstration of the Spirit of God and the power of that Spirit and the anointing of that Spirit and the touch of that Spirit that can change us from glory to glory, and it can bring us out, and he can establish us. He can establish our goings. He will guide our feet as we step, because he said the steps of a righteous man are ordered by God. And he said that he would guide us and he would lead us in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. He even said if we had to go through the valley of the shadow of death, he said we would fear no evil, for he was with us. He said his rod and his staff would comfort us. He said even in the midst of our enemies, he would prepare a place for us, a table for us, and he would serve us in the presence of our enemies. And in the midst of serving us, he said there would be something that would happen within our spirit, and all of a sudden our cup would run over. And as it ran over, we would testify and we would say, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. There was a triumphant yell that came forth from the psalmist David that said, Don't look at me as I am now, but you get ready to look at me when my cup runs over and you understand that in the house of God, there I will dwell forever. Hallelujah. I came in here this past Monday, I think it was, and as I came in here, I told them, I said, I just got to go to the sanctuary. It was good to see my staff, and it was good to see all them, and I loved on them for a while, but I said, just let me get to the sanctuary. I understood what David said when he said, I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. At the very beginning of this lesson tonight, I want to express to you what I feel is the direction of the Spirit in these last days as the children of God. And I want to ask you to please pay close attention to what I say. Tonight, I'm very honored to dedicate a brand new Bible for Brother Richard Drain. I love this Bible. I love this particular translation. It's called the New Living Translation. And Lord, I ask you to let it be a light unto his steps and a lamp unto his path. But here we are in the middle of Holy Week, the time that we reflect back and we see the sacrifices of the Lamb of God and what he experienced in his victories and in his sufferings, in his overcoming power, where Jesus once and for all made it clear that he is Lord both of the living and of the dead. And he is triumphantly sitting at the right hand of the Father. And the scripture says that as he sits there, he ever makes intercession for you and I. You hear me. You hear me. You hear me, Miller family. He ever makes intercession for you and I. It doesn't matter what we go through. It doesn't matter what we face. There is a great cloud of witnesses around us that can say, I know what you've been through. I know what you're going through. I know what you're facing. But sir, ma'am, if God brought me through it, he'll bring you through it. He's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And with him, there is no respecter of person. Just hang with me for a little while. I've asked the Lord not to let me preach long just because I hadn't preached in a couple services. I don't want to take it all out on the Wednesday night crowd. My Lord, but understand, Pastor made a statement a few days ago wherein I stated for the world 2017 is going to be a horrific time. And I'm telling you, I said that in the month of January, and you can see it being put into shape now, especially if you watch the news as of late and if you live the news such as Pastor does. You can see it. You can see what's going on. If you've seen the news or the press meeting just a few moments ago between our Secretary of State and the heads of Russia, you will see that it was a very cold, very distant, very pointed meeting. You will see that there was anger, and you will see that there was things such as the report came that our relationship with Russia is at an all-time low. Now, this is the same administration that the certain media outlets will tell you that that President Trump and Putin was the best of buddies. But now we're on the brink of war. And I want you to hear me, and you take that. You say, Pastor, how can that be? Because Daniel said that God was going to put a hook in the jaw of that bear, and he was going to bring that bear down. Neil Persia, he was going to bring it down. He was going to raise its head. And for that to take place, the church has got to be out of here 7 years before that ever takes place. But there's some things got to be set in motion. There's some people got to get mad. There's some things, there's some warlords got to flex their muscle. But before it ever takes place, the trump of God's going to sound. I said the trump of God's going to sound. The church triumphant. It's going to rise off of planet Earth. We're going to go to the marriage supper of the Lamb of God. We're going to the marriage supper. We're on our way. Somebody's got to get mad. Somebody's got to get mad. Somebody I've never seen in times such as these. Never seen times such as these. Never seen times where you can't make a phone call on your cell phone that it cannot be traced. Anytime you walk into your house, somebody told me the other day, and we have people sitting in our audience tonight, they're working in integral workings of the government. They know what's going on, and I'm having conversations with them. They work with hierarchy out of Washington, D.C., and they know what's going on. And I'm telling you, the world system is in the most fragile place that it's ever been tonight than at any other time in this history. And I'm talking about World War I and World War II. I set a young man down in my living room last night till pretty late in the night, and I told him I didn't want him joining the armed forces. The reason I don't is because never have I seen times such as this right now, because we got men and women that's willing to go and fight, but we got politicians fighting political wars at the cost of the red blood of Americans, and they could care less as long as it doesn't mess with their bank account and it doesn't mess with what they've already set in order. I'm tired of our young men and women being sent off to war, but tell them they can't fight to win. Bless God, I believe if you go to war, you ought to be given every weapon in the arsenal to win, and you ought to fight, and you ought to be able to win the battle. I want to get off on that. But we live in a time and an hour in times such as these that I've never seen before on planet Earth. We're living in times when mamas are having babies, but they don't know how to be mama. We're living in times when young men are giving birth to a child, but they know nothing about fatherhood. We're living in times when our teenage girls are giving away their virginity at a young age, and our young boys are giving away their virginity at a young age, and daddies and mamas are promoting it because it gives them a place on the ball team or the soccer field or the baseball diamond or the basketball court. I want to tell you something, folks. We believe in purity around here, and we still got a basketball court you can play on. We believe in holiness and sobriety, and I'm telling you, we need some men and women of God that'll stand up again and say, I'll not only father a child, I'll be a daddy, and I'll be a father, and I'll lead that child according to God's word. I want to get on all that mess. You take it up with the boss. But I want you to understand, it's going to be a horrific time. And my heart just quenched on Palm Sunday as they walked into our synagogues and they walked into our churches and they blowed themselves up and they killed people that was there for worship. And all of a sudden in Massachusetts, I think it was, things got so hard that churches called off service on Sunday, last past Sunday morning, because they was afraid of retaliation against everything else that's going on. And they was afraid for their people to come in. They was afraid they couldn't protect them. I want to tell you something, Milligan. You come to church Sunday, you're going to be protected. You come to church Sunday, the power of the Holy Ghost will protect you. The power of the anointing of the Holy Ghost will protect you. The power of that Spirit will protect you. We're not ignorant. We're not going to stick our head in the sand and act like it's not there. There's power to save. But I want to tell you, we're not going to let somebody just come in and threaten our people and try to disrupt service. If they come to disruption, they're going to find their honey on the outside. But if they come to see God and worship, come on in. The house of God will be open, and the Spirit of God will be falling like rain. I stated a few days ago that 2017 is going to be a horrific time. But for the child of God that has proven themselves faithful and will remain faithful in the midst of times such as these, God's going to show himself strong, and he's going to bless his children in every way possible. I looked at my family and I declared that. I look at my family here and I declare that. You say, Pastor, I'm waiting. Well, just quit waiting and start expecting. I don't care what the doctor said was in the breast. I don't care what he said about the valves being stopped up. I don't care what your banker's saying. I don't care what the lawyer's saying. I'm telling you, there's a God that's able to come and with one wave of his hand, all creation has to pay allegiance and attention to it. We serve a God that's going to be a God of blessing, and I believe he's going to bring it to his children. I believe he's going to bring it to his children. Notice, does not, at the same time, I must say this. At the same time, that does not mean as children of God that we're not going to face times of difficulty. We're going to do it. He said, for the righteous, we shall suffer persecution. We're going to have times of difficulties. We're going to have times of trials, times of need. But I do believe in times such as these, God is going to be faithful, and he's going to show us that he's still both Lord of the living and of the dead. I said he's both Lord of the living and of the dead. He's Lord of both. He's Lord of both. St. Paul described to Timothy times called perilous, times that would be serious times, times of immediate danger, times of great jeopardy, insecure times, uncertain times, times of injury, times of loss, times of destruction, times of risk, times of hurt and pain, times of great danger. And tonight we're surely living in times such as these. We're living in these times. Since we've last gathered in this holy place, some of your lives have been forever altered. Some of your lives have been forever altered. And your spiritual existence has been put to the test. Just since Sunday, as you gathered in this house, times have been altered. Your spiritual existence is being put to the test. Trials, tests, an evil report from a doctor. The attorney called and said it wasn't looking good. A child has gone into a coma. A dad fell from a tree that's 20 foot in the air, and he passed away this morning. Things beyond our control is now in control, and it's going to take a supernatural move of the Spirit of God for those things to somehow change. Did you hear what I said? Things beyond our control is now in control. And it's going to take a supernatural move of God to bring a change. Look at your neighbor and tell them, I love you. Just reach over and hug them. Baby hug Brother Scott. He ain't got nobody hugging. It's going to take the supernatural power of God for things to change. Sister Joanne Hebert called me just a few hours ago, hysterical. Her only granddaughter at 10 years of age went into a diabetic coma. She was frantic on the other end of the line. I promised her, we prayed, and we still encouraged her. A few hours later, she's getting on the airplane, and she was headed yesterday morning over to see her granddaughter, the only granddaughter she had, in a diabetic coma at the age of 10. That was all she has. She don't have another granddaughter. I can remember when she came, and I believe I dedicated her. I'm not for sure I did dedicate her. She came. No, I didn't dedicate her. I don't know. But anyway, yes, I did. I dedicated her. Are you confused yet? I dedicated that grandbaby. My goodness. I dedicated that grandbaby, but Sister Joanne was frantic. She was just saying, oh, Pastor, God's got to move. God's got to do something. as she landed just about 2.5 hours later after she got in an airplane and she got to the hospital. She sent me these pictures right here that she see on your wall. That's what we sent over there as a gift. There her granddaughter is. That's the gift we gave her. There's another picture on there. That's her granddaughter. She walked in and her granddaughter woke up. She said, Pastor, she just woke up and she started speaking to me. I'm telling you, desperate times called for a mighty God to move in a great way, preacher. Shout, son. Shout. Shout. Desperate time called for a desperate God to move in a desperate way. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sister Joanne sent us these pictures showing us that prayer can outrun an airplane. Prayer can outrun an airplane. Hallelujah. That thrilled me. There's no time and space in God, pastors. There's no time and space in God, child of God. It doesn't matter how great it is or how bad it looks in times such as these. We got a great, wonderful Lord. We got a kinsman redeemer that'll stand up and say, it's my stripes they're healed by. It's my power that they're encouraged by. It's my anointing that they're led by. And it's by my authority. Devil, I'm telling you, in the name above every name, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, you have no right in the child of God's life. A few hours later, yesterday, a great man that painted our family life center. I know his daddy. I've been knowing his daddy for years. A great man that painted our family life center. He called. His dad was in a tree at his house, cutting off a limb that was rubbing the top of his house. His dad fell 20 feet, and as he fell 20 feet, they told me that he broke his neck in several places and broke his back in several places, and they airlifted him to Dothan Hospital. We began to pray. We began to seek God. He went through the first surgery. Yesterday afternoon, he was alive and awake. He was sitting in a wheelchair. They called us this morning about 6:30. My son did. He was shook up. He was worried. He said, Daddy, right out of nowhere, Brother O.C. Moore just left this world this morning. Just left and went home to be with the Lord. They just trust the family. But can I tell you, the same God that was with that 10-year-old baby, he was with that 72-year-old man. And he made the decision. He said, I'll leave this, but I'm going to take this. He ain't got to go through life with a broke up neck and back. He ain't got to live in a wheelchair. I'll just take him on home and be with me. And you say, Pastor, how can you explain it? I can't explain it, but I trust the one that knows, and his name is Jesus Christ, and we need him in times such as these. Need him in times such as these. Lady that was dear, that is dearly beloved by me and my lady. We watched her daughter get saved. We watched her daughter as she came to our Christian school that we had. We watched her as she went up through the grades. We watched her in her talent. We watched her. They gave us a notification yesterday morning, I believe it was, that she had been missing for 2 days. That she had been missing. They couldn't find Mama. Mama nowhere. Didn't know where she was. My lady told me about it. I went outside. I came back in. I told her, I said, her husband done it. Her husband's done it this afternoon after hunting her for 2 days and two nights this afternoon on the backside of their property in a ditch about waist high. They found her in that ditch, beat almost to death, tied up in cords, and her own husband is the one that done it, beat her. You say, Pastor, how can you explain that? I can tell you how I explain that. When the devil tried to kill her, the one in day and time such as these, the God that I know and the God that she knew, she knows, she's alive tonight. Her husband's in jail, but she's alive. I thank God for that. I said, she's alive. She's alive. I can't explain it. I don't know. I can't reason it away. If I'd been God, Brother Jerome, I'd squeeze that man's heart and kill him on the spot. But I'm not God. But I'm telling you this, in times such as these, we need more than just a religion. We need an experience in God that'll take us through the dark time, take us through the cloudy time, and take us through the good time. But we need God. We need God. Yesterday morning, we were notified by Brother Miller and his lady as they came to my pastoral office to meet with me. The doctors have given them a report that he's in stage four. There's a stage four mass in his lungs, and it's probably gone up to his neck. I'm talking about in times such as these. And I'm telling you, listen to me, brother. You listen to your pastor. I want you to hear me. I ain't going to sit by, and I ain't going to let you lay down, and I ain't going to let you quit, and I ain't going to let you give up. Thank you, son. And I ain't going to let you stop. And Sister Lisa, you hear me? If I have to hold you down every time you come in this sanctuary, when you come in this sanctuary, you may be coming in tired. You may be coming weary from the battle, but I got news for you. When you walk in this place, God's going to touch both of you. I'm not willing to give you up. I'm not willing to say no. I'm telling you, we're going to fight. We're going to pray. We're going to believe. We're going to stand. For in time such as this, we need more than a religion. We need a God that can stand up and say no to cancer. Say no to leukemia. Say no. Say no. Say no. Hallelujah. Times such as these, I want you to know, Brother Edis, it wasn't easy on Pastor either. Because that's why I asked the Lord permission for me to leave my last church. I couldn't stand it. My lady knew last night we were supposed to go to Forrest's and KK's house, and I said, which is Sister Teresa Rainey's home. And I said, I can't go there today. Can't go there today. Not today. Not today. But can I tell you, in times such as this, the Lord said, I will not give you a spirit of fear, but I'll give you a spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind. I'll give you that spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind. And right in the middle of every bit of it, right in the middle of it all, I received notification yesterday from a Catholic school in Tulsa, Oklahoma, that this week they're studying on the phenomenon of Pentecostalism. They're studying on the phenomenon of Pentecostalism. And all week long this week in that Catholic school, they were instructed in that Catholic school to go to this website, www.milliganassembly.com. And they were instructed to go to that website. And they are to go and look at our services to experience what Pentecost is all about. I'm telling you, in the middle of it all, in the middle of time such as this, there's got to be a church somewhere that is there to stand up. Oh, right in the middle of that Catholic school, studying in the middle of Holy Week on Pentecostalism. They got a dialed up a little country church in Okaloosa County to find, I don't know how many schools they are in Tulsa, Oklahoma, but there's a bunch of them. But I'm telling you, I want to shout it to the world. I'm glad we're Pentecostal. I said, I'm glad we're Pentecostal. I'm glad we're Pentecostal. I'm glad. Thank you, brother. I'm glad we're Pentecostal. Anybody glad you're Pentecostal? Hallelujah. The outpouring of the Spirit upon the believer. That's why we shout. That's why we run. That's why we speak in tongues. That's why we lay hands on the sick and see them recover in time such as these. We need the outpouring of the presence of God. They said they wanted to do it to see Pentecostalism in action. Had to sit in a class. I just believe some of them is going to sit there, and I'm praying, God, right in the middle of all this, I pray as they begin to watch that, hallelujah, there'll be some shatalabahaya running out of them. I pray there'll be something that they'll look at one student or look at the other and go, I don't know why, but I'm seeing them run. All of a sudden, I want to run. I don't know why, but I'm seeing them praising God. All of a sudden, I want to praise God. Can we just give the Lord a shout of praise? They that turn the world upside down. I was going to say this for later, but I might not get to later. Hallelujah. I got to tell you something. We was coming in late Sunday afternoon, and we got to about Tallahassee, and I had my lady call our children and told them to meet us at the Pizza Hut. We'd eat supper on the way in. We got in, and my son was sitting across from the table from me, and he said, Daddy, I got to tell you what happened. I said, okay, son, tell me. Hallelujah. And he said, last Sunday morning, in one of their local churches that doesn't believe in the baptism of the Holy Ghost, he said, in the middle of their morning worship service, the biggest church in town, middle of their morning worship service. Said right in the middle of the morning worship service, just like in Nehemiah's day. Said right over there, they said a woman that was devil possessed, said that thing started manifesting itself. Right in the middle of whatever it was they were doing. He said, Daddy, in a minute it just started flopping around on the floor. In what? Foaming at the mouth. Right in the middle of all that, an institution that says it's the church. All of a sudden, they got up and somebody said, you better call 911. And the doctor called 911. The ambulance came and removed her from the sanctuary. I want to tell you something. We got something in this house that's greater than any manifestation of any demon. And his name is the Holy Ghost. We won't call 911, but we'll lay hands on them. And God said it'd have to come out under the power and the anointing of the Holy Ghost. I thought about that scripture that says When that sons of Sheba laid hands on that and that's demon possessed and they just stripped them good and that thing growled back and said, Paul we know and Peter we know. But who are you? Hallelujah. I'm telling you, I want you to know something. In times such as these, you better have enough of the Holy Ghost inside of you that if you go to the post office and the devil's anywhere around, he'll have to leave because of the power and the anointing of God that's living inside of your life. Just jump to your feet and give God about 30 seconds of red hot praise. Let him know you love him in this house tonight. Hallelujah, Richard. This thing's real. This thing's real. This thing's real. I ain't gonna get there. We try to be done by 20 after 8 on Wednesday night. I want to tell you something, beloved. Here, Pastor, I want you to hear me. We're living in a day and in an hour and time such as this that we must. It's not a question of whether or not we need to know for a surety in times as these. If you go to a church like that, for God's sake, get out of it. No, you don't even have to come here, but get out of it and go somewhere where the power of the Spirit of God can be poured out like water. Hallelujah. You know what's happening? I want to show you what Jesus sees. I want to show you what Jesus sees in a lot of churches. The Spirit of God will go to move it in churches. He starts raining down the Spirit. We don't want to get in on this. We don't want to get in on this. We don't want to get in on this. We don't want to get wet with that power. But I remember watching Mary Poppins. And they a wind that can come. And it can twirl that umbrella of Mary Poppins. And I watched her start flying through the air. And today I pray, God, I don't care wherever there's an umbrella up that says, I don't need none of that. I pray you'd get under the lid of that umbrella and just lift them up and do unto them a whole lot worse than you would have done if they had never popped it up in the beginning. But pour out on them. Make them do something that'll just embarrass them real good. Just embarrass them real good. But in times such as these, the tappings and the trappings of religious Christianity is seen, but sadly, without no power. I don't understand how people can get by on humanistic philosophy. Where I can take a philosophy and I can adapt it to the worth of my soul. I don't see how it can be done. I don't see how people can do it. When they just take a philosophy and they say, I'll bank my soul on that philosophy. Not me. Mine is this. For God so loved this world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Have everlasting life. I know I haven't got anywhere with this, but I want to take you real quickly to 2 Timothy 4. And I want you to hear what he said. He said, time will come when no longer will they endure sound doctrine. No longer will they endure sound doctrine. I want to say this to you. The order of this house will not swallow just anything. We won't hook our wagon up to just anything that's pulling. But if it's soundness of doctrine, then we're going to hook up to it. And we're going to get behind it. And we're going to understand that we will not deny what God said that we could have in the covers of his divine word. Are we going to have to go through some things? Yes. We got some people that's been through some stuff. Sarah and Craig. And there's some people that's going through some things. And we met some people here last night as we took Brother and Sister Miller out for supper last night. We met some people that's been through some things. Brother Randy and his lady, they've been through some stuff. But can I tell you, this will just warm you up for Sunday, and I don't mean to do it. I don't mean to preach about something that the Lord's laid upon me, because when I do that, he normally changes it. But I won't just say this to you. As a child of God, you hear, Pastor, as a child of God, not even the gates of hell. Not even the gates of hell. I want you to stand to your feet. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm not talking about an Alexander Coppersmith experience. I'm not talking about a soothsaying experience. I'm talking about in times such as this. I want you to get ready to be blessed. I don't care what comes. I don't care what goes. I don't care what is spoken over you. I want you to get ready to be blessed. Because I believe mortal is about to put on immortality. I do. I do. I believe we're going to get to a place in this house very quickly, because I don't think we have but a short time that we can command both flesh and spirit. I believe we're going to see it. I believe people is going to regurgitate tumors on the floor of this sanctuary. I believe they're going to regurgitate it. I believe bones and aches that have gone through trying times, all of a sudden the Holy Ghost 10W40, DW40 is going to come. And it's going to just spray on you. Things that are squeaking no longer going to squeak. Hallelujah. Things that's hurting no longer going to hurt. And you're going to go to the bank, and you're going to find out that your storehouse is being more blessed than it's ever been at any other time. You're going to go there. Amen. Amen. I'm telling you, God promised me if I pay my tithes, I give my offerings, and I obey his word, and I be faithful, he promised me he would bless me good measure, shaken together, pressed down, and running over. And that's not just with financial things. That's with health. That's with relationship. That's with everything else, with your family. That's with everything else. Look at your neighbor, slap them upside the head, and say, get ready to be blessed. In times such as these, in times such as this, in times such as this, get ready. Get ready to be blessed, Brother Johnny. I know you are. I know many of you's walking in the fields of high clover. But whether you believe it or not, if you'll just whack some of that clover down and put it over here and put it over there and give some of it away, next time you go back and look, clover that was that high will be this high. Well, I felt the spirit of just something get on me. Hallelujah. I'm going to warn every preacher that preaches behind this pulpit, just so you'll know, this is a danger spot. How many of you want the Lord with you in times such as these? I know I didn't get far, but it's Wednesday night and the baby's got to get home. But I want to tell every one of you, you may have to go through some stuff, but God will go through it with you. I got his word on it, Brother Butts. He said he'd never leave us or forsake us. Never. Heavenly Father, I love you now. Father, you know how I love your sheep. You know how I feel about them. Father, you know tonight what every one of them's going through. Father, you know what they face on a daily basis. You hear the condemnation of the enemy that's in their ears. You see the weapons of warfare that's fashioned against them. God, you hear everything, God, that comes their way. Nothing catches you by surprise. And tonight, God, I just ask you to be with your kids, God. Be with them. Bless them above anything that they can fathom within their mind's eye and their spirit's heart. Be with them, God. Bless them abundantly above anything they can ask or think. Father, keep them safe. Keep evil reports at arm's length. It's okay, God, if they have to pick it up and read it, but God, from their hand to their heart, never let it take seed. Never let it take seed. Let them keep it at arm's length. Have your way. God, we celebrate your life, death, and resurrection. God, we cry Hosanna in the highest to you today. And we give you praise and glory for all that you've done, all that you shall do, and all that you ever will be. We give you praise for it. Be with your kids, Lord, and I'll thank you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Listen, don't forget to bring your family Easter Sunday. If you have to con them into coming here, just con them. Just whatever you got to do, get them here. Turn them, and listen, I don't know if you've heard this or not, but we want to take your picture on Sunday morning. So we want to ask you to show up about 9:30 if you can. We want to take your picture, so remember that, your family's picture, okay? Turn around, hug somebody, tell them it's great to see them in the house of God.